Hey folks, I'm back with you again. My name is Seth Mayo, curator of astronomy for the Lohmann Planetarium. And for this week, we're covering the sky tonight from September 14th through September 20th. And this is the last full week of summer before, of course, the fall begins. And we're gonna take a look at some of the things we can see this week in the sky, particularly the moon and the morning sky for those early risers. And we'll have an opportunity just to briefly talk about how to get into buying and using a telescope. So let's get to it. So for this week, the sun sets just before 7:30. And also, this is the last full week that our days are longer than our nights. We're about to enter into the equinox for equal amount of day and night. And then once we get past that, once the fall begins, then our nights will start to be longer than our days. So you'll start to see that transition happen at this time of the year. For the evening sky, once it gets dark, by about 8:30 at this time of the year, we still have a great view of those summertime stars and constellations. We'll have plenty of time to see them even into the fall. And some of these we've brought up recently, like Scorpius the Scorpion in the south. He is getting kind of lower in the southwestern part of the sky. Not far from him, we have Sagittarius still, the half-man, half-horse centaur. And then above those two, really high up, the three stars of the summer triangle with those three constellations, Aquila the Eagle, Lyra the Harp, and Cygnus the Swan. So you'll easily see these constellations even after the summer technically ends. And something else to remember, Jupiter and Saturn are still here in this area, Jupiter to the right and Saturn to the left, that is not as bright. What's great is they're getting closer and closer to each other until they meet or form what's called a conjunction when they get really close as viewed from Earth, and that will happen in December. So we can kind of watch as these two planets slowly drift closer and closer to each other for that great conjunction coming up by the end of the year. Fairly soon, we'll have the opportunity to talk about those fall constellations you can see in the east in the next couple of episodes of the Sky Tonight program. But for now, let's talk about some wonderful objects you can find in this area of the sky in the early morning, especially if you're up before sunrise. So let's speed through the rest of the evening here. And as we do, you'll see things rising out of the east since Earth spins towards the east. Late at night, you'll see Mars getting higher and higher and earlier to see. We are getting closer to Mars as Mars approaches opposition, which occurs on October 13th. But if you're up pretty early in the morning, well past midnight, you'll actually see winter constellations. And these are very bright. So let's go to about 6 in the morning where we can see many of these stars and constellations, another planet, and even our moon. This is Tuesday morning, the 15th. So this is a nice view for those early risers. And in this area, which we have spoken about before in the past, you see three stars here of Orion's belt and his shoulder stars here. Here's legs and feet. And his right shoulder, one of my favorite named stars, Betelgeuse. And this is all part of Orion the Hunter. And not far from him, Orion's belt does point to the brightest star in the sky named Sirius, which is part of one of Orion's dogs, known as Canis Major. The dog's also known as Sirius as well. And not far from Sirius or Canis Major are these two stars and the bright star Procyon that marks Orion's small dog, Procyon, or Canis Minor. And if you look a little higher up above Orion, you'll see a V shape of stars. That is a star cluster that forms the nose of Taurus the Bull. And not far from that as well is a really tiny little cluster that many notice in the fall and winter time, the stars of Pleiades or the Seven Sisters. It's commonly thought of as the Little Dipper. It does look like it, but it's a cluster of stars that forms the Pleiades star cluster, and that's all part of Taurus the Bull. And not far from that is Mars. So this is a really nice view in the morning. And even another planet right here is the planet Venus right there. So we have Venus shining brightly. It is the brightest planet you can see from Earth, so it really shines. And just yesterday morning, the moon was next to Venus. We'll just reverse time a little bit here and show you the very thin crescent moon was close to the second planet from the sun. And for Tuesday morning, you'll notice the moon is still a thin crescent, even thinner actually, a waning crescent just above the eastern horizon before the sun rises. So again, this is Tuesday morning, the 15th, but even if you're not out on this particular morning, any morning this week and even next week as well, the sky will look pretty much like this with all these wonderful winter stars kind of getting you ready for that time of the year and the planet Venus as well, which is nice. Continuing our discussion about the moon, we're back in the evening sky looking in about the southwestern area. And on the 17th is a new moon. That's when the back side of the moon is being lit by the sun. So we can't see the moon at this point from Earth. But if we go just a few days after that, by the end of this week, and you're looking towards the southwest or the western part of the horizon, not long after sunset, you'll see that the very thin crescent moon will rise. So there it is. And by Sunday, you'll see it just high enough and just big enough of a crescent that it will be a little more noticeable, not far from Scorpius, the Scorpion, by the end of the week here. So you'll find the moon will be some nice kind of thinner phases, but these are my favorite phases to look at. Now, the last thing I want to mention in this episode are about telescopes. And this is something I get a lot of requests about or questions about is, what kind of telescope should I get? Or what brand or make or model should I get? And what I always say is keep it simple. My first recommendation is get to know the night sky. That's the first step. Learn the sky, learn the basics. Just get comfortable with navigating the stars, the constellations, and the planets using a star chart on paper or a star chart on your phone. They have digital ones, or programs like this one, Stellarium, or other digital programs or apps that you can download for your phone or for your computer. A lot of great free tools that you can use to learn the sky and get comfortable with it. Once you do that, then maybe move on to binoculars. Binoculars are a great way to view the sky. Most people have them. And even if you don't, you can invest in a relatively inexpensive pair of astronomical binoculars. And these have a wider aperture, so a wider opening in the front that allow a little more starlight into each eyepiece. So you can see the night sky even better. And the great thing about binoculars, it gives you a very wide field of the sky. So it can really show you the Milky Way very nicely, or star clusters, or just huge swaths of the sky that you can't get in a telescope. A telescope has a very narrow field of view. Depends on the size of the telescope, but a telescope will only give you a very small section. Binoculars are great for those very wide swaths of the sky. So that's a great place to begin. If you want to take that next big step in actually purchasing a telescope, most likely your accessibility to them is going to be online. Brick and mortar stores are harder to come by. And the companies online that are pretty well known and reputable are Meade, Celestron, Orion, Explore Scientific, just to name a few. There are many others, and this is no endorsement for any particular brand that I've mentioned here. These are just some of the popular brands to have high quality optics and equipment for you to buy at various levels and stages of your expertise. So I'd recommend one of those or others if you do your research to purchase your first telescope. And if you're looking for ideas for the type of telescope, a good place to start is maybe a refracting scope. So one that uses lenses, a type of telescope that most people think of when you think of these devices to look at the universe. And they're very simple. And especially if you buy one on an alt azimuth mount. That's very similar to a camera tripod mount, and all you do is you can turn it left, right, up, and down. Very easy to point and great tool to look at planetary objects or the moon, things like that. The moon is great. Jupiter is awesome. Saturn, Mars is very cool too to look at, and other deep sky objects as well. But that's a good place to start. If you want something a bit bigger and heftier, because the bigger the telescope, the better, because it allows more light to enter into the scope and eventually to your eye, a big reflector type. So a reflector is a telescope that uses mirrors instead of lenses. And you can get a type of reflector sitting on what's called a Dobsonian mount. These are pretty big. You can get them at 6-inch apertures, 8-inch, 10, even greater than that. And that's the opening of the telescope. And they're not the most expensive type. They're easy to use, so you can just kind of move them around very easily. They're large, so they have a great view of deep sky objects. And again, they're not as expensive. They're a little bigger though, so maybe something you don't want to move around a lot or use on camping trips and things like that. Maybe you want to keep it at home, but that's great for kind of bang for your buck type of telescope. If you're more advanced, then maybe you want to get into reflector scopes on what are called equatorial mounts that track the sky a little more precisely. And Cassegrain telescopes, those are a lot more expensive, but nice and portable with large apertures. And eventually, maybe, again, if you have the expertise and the budget for it, a go-to telescope, one that has a computer attached to it that allows you to point to various things. But I would say don't go to one of the go-to telescopes first. Even though it sounds really nice and spiffy, they take some experience to set up. You got to know the sky a bit, and they can be very frustrating at first. And one thing I always want to prevent is from people buying a telescope, using it, getting frustrated, and then putting it in their closet. It's the most common thing I've seen and something I want to prevent. So start simple, make it easy, and when you're finally purchasing a telescope, go for something $100 or more. That's the price I usually go by. You could go a little less than that, but if you want a decent mount, a couple eyepieces, and a decent telescope, I'd say $100 or more from one of the companies I mentioned or others is a great place to start, and you can do a lot with that. So hopefully you get a chance to use a telescope and buy one successfully. If you want more information about it, you can access this telescope guide that I put together last year that dives a little deeper into different telescopes, how they work, what to buy, and even how to set them up. And you can access this guide at the link provided in the description, and you can download as PDF. So it's a great user guide to get you started with observing the sky through a telescope. So hopefully you'll have some luck with telescope buying if you're interested in that. But like I said earlier, keep it simple. Don't go for something too cheap. And learn the sky really well first. Get comfortable with that. And again, get comfortable with even using binoculars starting out. So thanks again for tuning in. Glad to have you back. Again, come by the Lowen Planetarium. We are open and doing shows every single day. And we'll see you again soon. Take care. Happy stargazing and happy telescope using, potentially. Bye-bye.